Hello and welcome to Birmingham Vineyard 10 a.m. service. We're so glad that you've chosen to be with us today. My name is Lorna and I'm part of the service leader team.
And I'm Jo and I'm one of the site pastors here. You are so welcome. You know, as a church, we all love to we just really love to follow Jesus and live our lives to the full in the freedom that he brings to us and try to make a difference to our communities around us. And we've been really loving hearing the stories of the ways in which you guys have been doing that during lockdown. Do keep in touch. Do keep telling us what you've been up to and tell your friends about what God's been doing during this time as well.
We enjoy starting our service by connecting with God through song worship. After that, we'll hear a message from Adam in our series of Jonah. And then there will be time to respond to God with prayer and some more worship. Throughout the service, we're all welcome to strengthen each other in our faith. Feel free to join in on the chat and share scriptures, prayers, or any other encouragement that you feel God is putting in your heart, on your heart, sorry. And after the service, we'll enjoy a meetup for coffee.
Yes.
And a chat with each other on Zoom.
Yeah, that'll
Sorry, carry on, Jo.
No, that's fine. I'm saying that it's really good fun. We love meeting up and seeing everyone's faces, don't we?
Yes, we sure do. Everyone's welcome, including visitors.
Yeah.
We'll let you know the details later.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks, Lorna. So we're going to go into some song words now. We're going to, you know, song worship isn't just like karaoke. It isn't just like read the sing along to the words on the screen. For us, it's really important that it's authentic and we're actually connecting with God and we're connecting with who he is and what he wants to say to us and with his nature. So I'd ask you now to just, yeah, prepare yourself for worship. Just clear your mind of anything that's been, you know, bugging you through the week. Just try and turn your heart to God. And, you know, really in my heart, I've just really got a sense of thanksgiving this morning. And so I would love to read Psalm 100. So let's just read that and praise the Lord. So shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us. We are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. Lord, we just thank you for who you are. We thank you for your goodness to us. We thank you for your faithfulness and your love that you have for us. Lord, we just are so delighted to welcome you here today into our homes. Lord, will you be with us through the service? And Lord, we just bring our worship to you now. We pray that that will just bless you and glorify your name. In Jesus' name, amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Go. the kingdom yours? Is the power yours? Is the glory forever? Amen. Oh, yours is the kingdom yours? Is the power yours? Is the glory forever?
Oh, dear Lord Jesus, we give you glory. We thank you. We thank you for your presence and your love amongst us this morning, Lord. We just want to glorify you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Welcome. A special welcome today to those who are joining us for the first time. A connect button will come through on the chat now. And if you'd like to connect in with our community, we'd love to learn about how we can best support and encourage you. Feel free to click on the button, pop through your details, and one of our team will be in touch.
Absolutely. And we'd also like to take this opportunity to give a really big thank you to all of those who so generously give regularly to the church. There is going to be a give button that comes up in the chat right now. But if you're a visitor here, you're just so welcome. Please don't feel compelled to give anything. We're just really, really glad that you're here and that you could join us.
Right. Now, it's been wonderful to hear how many people in our church community have been making a difference in their communities over the last few months. Today, we're checking in with Michael Yu. Let's hear how he's been making a difference.
Well, hello, everyone. Today, we are interviewing Michael. Michael, why don't you tell us a little bit about what you do and how your role has changed as a result of this COVID period?
Yeah, so I'm a research scientist and I'm currently doing my PhD with the University of Birmingham, and I work in the Queen Elizabeth Hospital. So normally I'd be working on a clinical trial. We'd be having patients coming in and healthy volunteers coming in to take part in research. And then I take those samples through to the lab and play around with them, generate some sciencey data on them with the aim of improving our therapies for patients that have chronic lung disease. But obviously, because of COVID, all of those studies have been paused. We've been kicked out of the hospital for our own safety and for their safety as well. And it's meant that I've kind of had an office job from home. And my supervisor is a respiratory consultant and said, well, doctors are struggling to keep up with the latest research that's coming out with coronavirus. And obviously at the beginning, and as it is now, it's rapidly evolving. So asked us as a research team, can you look through all of the papers that are coming out, see which ones are good, have good advice in, and to put them together into a report. And then I would turn those reports into infographics that could then be displayed in the hospital and around trusts in the UK to help doctors kind of quickly get that information and understand what was going on in the scientific literature. So that's kind of where my focus has shifted over this period of time. And writing my thesis, which I don't particularly enjoy, so I kind of just push that to one side.
Well, Michael, that sounds like you're right in the middle of it, you know, providing such an important role between the reports coming out and the doctors on the ground. That's amazing. What's the biggest challenge that you and your colleagues have faced as a result of that time?
Yeah, so for a lot of us as basic scientists, it's been adapting to a kind of a 100% office job, which is, you know, the majority of us. It's the reason we went into research sciences, because we didn't want an office job. So that's kind of the change that we've had to go through. But some of the team as well are medics and doctors, and they've been called back to the front line. So it's kind of been thinking of them as well, who are obviously having to go into the hospital every day and working on the front line. And just it's been nice in some ways to play some sort of role, even though we can't help them out in that physical capacity, being able to do something from home. So that was kind of the initial challenge. And now it's kind of trying to work out how we carry on doing our jobs, but, you know, safely returning to work and in the hospital safely, and how we kind of start up the research studies again.
Yeah, wow. That seems like a really big challenge, trying to morph and move with the times and do what's possible in the times. What has brought you hope or encouragement in this time?
I think it's been really great having like the grounding of church and knowing that God is in control, and having that, just that knowledge and that peace around that, you know, God is ultimately in control. But it's also been really great practically just seeing how everyone has drawn together across all the different disciplines in the hospital and the university and like public and private sectors as well, just coming together around a common problem. And sometimes in research and in science, there's that kind of little bit of selfish attitude that comes in of like, oh, we want to be the ones that have like done that research and have our names to it. And it's been nice just seeing people just put that aside and say, actually, it doesn't matter anymore. We just need to get good quality information to help those that need it.
Yeah, that's so encouraging, seeing everyone to come together. How can we be praying for you and your colleagues as you've obviously done a bunch of work in the past few months and now you're sort of trying to transition into the future? How can we be praying for you and your colleagues?
Yeah, I think it is that transition back for those that have been working on the front line, that they get rest and recover and don't feel burnt out. And I suppose for the rest of us who are in that kind of planning phase of how we do things safely, just real wisdom in how we do that going forward. You know, how we can return to doing research, which is important, but safely and not kind of rushing into things. I think, yeah, are probably the two key things that people can be praying for.
Brilliant. Well, Michael, if it's okay with you, let's pray now.
Yes, great. Thank you.
Let's pray together. Father God, we just thank you that you are always in control, even in the midst of this unprecedented situation for many of for in our lifetime. God, we know that you are in control. Lord, we thank you for the work that Michael and his colleagues have been doing to bridge a gap between the reports coming out and the doctors on the front line. We thank you that you've worked through them to provide that resource. And so we ask, God, that you would just protect them and walk with them into this new season, Father, as they try and return back to some element of normal work that's so important even in non-COVID times. Would you help them to get priorities in place, have strategy and creative solutions where they can continue their research? We just pray also for those that are, who have transitioned onto the front lines as doctors and medical staff and now trying to transition back into research. Father, would you give them rest and recuperation? And would you protect them as well as they go back and try and transition in this time? Thank you, Lord. Will you just bless Michael's whole team and all his colleagues? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Well, Michael, thank you so much for joining us. We really appreciate your time. We're now going to transition to Adam, who is going to be preaching our next series on Jonah.
What do you do when you get in a strop? When somebody makes you angry? When you have a bit of a paddy? I'm sure if somebody's watching the service with you, they'll tell you. Or if you ask your friends and your family, they'll know exactly what you do. Today, we're continuing our series on the book of Jonah. And we're going to see Jonah get in a strop and get angry with God. This is the bit of the book of Jonah that people forget about. It's the weird final chapter after the people of Nineveh have believed God and turned from their evil ways. Tim Keller says this, of all the books in the Bible, Jonah has the most unexpected and overlooked final chapter. The book of Jonah is this subversive story about a rebellious prophet who despises God for loving his enemies. And through Jonah's story, we've had this opportunity to perform a spiritual checkup on ourselves and ask ourselves some questions like, do we run away from God when faced with difficult decisions? Do we truly forgive and love our enemies? The book of Jonah is brilliant because as we read it, we start to feel a bit puffed up and superior. And we look down on Jonah and think, what an idiot, what a hypocrite. I would never do something like that. And all of a sudden, it's like the writer says to us, gotcha, and shines a light inside of us. The book of Jonah ends with a question from God in chapter 4, verse 10. Shouldn't I feel sorry for this great city? The book invites us into an ongoing dialogue. We're not to put it down and just feel superior to Jonah, but to continually wrestle with the questions that the book throws up. Just a quick online resource for you. Have a look at the Bible Project podcast, and there's a question and response on the book of Jonah where people have emailed in all their tough questions about the book of Jonah, and the Bible Project guys engage with those questions. Really helpful stuff. But let's start by reading the book of Jonah, chapter 4, and I'm going to just reverse one verse to chapter 3, verse 10. It says this: when God saw what they did and how they turned from their evil ways, he relented and did not bring on them the destruction he had threatened. Then chapter 4, but to Jonah, this seemed very wrong, and he became angry. He prayed to the Lord, "Isn't this what I said, Lord, when I was still at home? This is what I tried to forestall by fleeing to Tarshish. I knew that you're a gracious and compassionate God, slow to anger and abounding in love, a God who relents from sending calamity. Now, Lord, take away my life, for it's better for me to die than to live." Jonah was a bit of a drama queen. Today, we're going to consider Jonah's anger, the scandal of God's grace, and radical enemy love. So firstly, Jonah's anger. When God saw that the Ninevites believed his message, despite the fact that Jonah had only given them a five-word sermon, God saw that they'd shown sorrow and turned from their evil ways, he relented. He had mercy on them and didn't carry out the destruction he had threatened. God changed his mind in response to the people. Now, just a quick side note, because I couldn't resist it. You may be thinking, does God change his mind? I thought God was supposed to be unchangeable. A really helpful quote from Martin Lloyd-Jones sort of solves this for us. He says this: God's character never changes, but his dealings with people change. And you know, this is not a defect in God's character, but it's part of his greatness, his supremacy, his sovereign beauty. Now back to Nineveh. Nineveh had more than 120,000 people there living there, the book tells us. Jonah had just seen the whole city turn to God after a five-word sermon. Now that's revival. Surely Jonah would have hung around in the city, started an alpha course, or done some discipleship groups. But no. Chapter 4 starts with Jonah's big but. Verse 1 says this: but to Jonah, this seemed very wrong, and he became angry. Jonah storms off out of the city, and he's not a happy bunny. Notice how many times in verses 1 to 3, Jonah says, "I." It's all about him. And when you read chapter 4, you can see parallels with the older brother in Jesus's parable of the prodigal son. Some people think that Jesus had the Jonah story in mind when he formulated that parable. Now, when we read verse 1 of Jonah chapter 4, we actually miss the power of it, because it literally reads, "It was evil to Jonah, a great evil." And the word here used for evil is the same word used by the writer in chapter 3, verse 10. It's about where he says the Ninevites turn from their evil ways. Jonah is comparing God's actions in relenting as evil with the evil of the Ninevites. What Jonah does here is repeat the sin of Adam and Eve in eating from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. It's our fundamental problem. It's that we place ourselves in the position of God and we try to judge between what we think is good and what we think is evil. And this judgment keeps us from doing the central thing that God created us and saved us to do, to love like he does. Now, it's easy at this point to look down at Jonah and feel superior to him. But I judge people all the time. I judge people all the time on the basis of how they look, what they say, where they're from. A real challenge to us at present is, do we unconsciously judge people by the color of their skin? Today, God wants to challenge us to be free of judgment. Now that starts by getting your worth, your significance, your security from Christ alone. And then some homework. When you see somebody, intentionally practice having your first thought be, this person is of infinite worth to Jesus. And in your mind, pray a prayer of blessing over them. When I'm out running at 6 a.m. in the morning, and sometimes a car may nearly run me over or somebody gets too close to me on a path, I try and consciously pray a blessing over them rather than condemn their soul to eternal damnation, which is very tempting, let me tell you. As we engage in this practice of blessing prayer, we'll start to notice how many non-blessing thoughts we have. Don't beat yourself up, but remember, God is the just judge, and our job is to agree with him that all people have insurpassable worth. Jonah just doesn't think this is all wrong. He gets angry, and he gets angry with God. Dallas Willard says that anger is the most fundamental problem in human life. We all struggle with anger. Jonah thought his anger was righteous, but actually it was coming from a place of judgment, which, as we've seen, is God's role, not ours. In reality, righteous anger is a myth in my life. I don't know about you. And as we've seen in verse 2, God is slow to anger. And the Bible consistently tells us to get rid of anger in our lives. Back to Dallas Willard, he has this brilliant, challenging statement about anger in his book, The Divine Conspiracy. He says this, "But there is nothing that can be done with anger that cannot be done better without it." There is nothing that can be done with anger that cannot be done better without it. Let that mess with your head a bit this week. But before I leave anger, I felt that some of us, maybe like Jonah today, and be angry with God. Some of us have maybe been hurt, or something's happened to you which has left you angry with God. And today God wants you to give over that anger to him, to let out what's eating away inside of you. And fair play to Jonah. He prayed to God about his anger. There's a raw honesty in his prayer, even if he's a bit of a drama queen. A number of us today have bottled up anger against God inside of us, and God wants you to tell him. He can take it. Just read the Psalms, where so often David pours out that raw emotion to God. Give your anger to God today. Secondly, then, the scandal of God's grace. In verse 2, we're finally told why Jonah did not want to go to Nineveh in the first place and instead ran away for a bit of a Spanish holiday, although he didn't get very far. It wasn't that he was afraid, but rather he knew God, what God was like, and he didn't want him to have grace and mercy on the people of Nineveh. So Jonah's shouting at God, "I knew you would do this. I told you so." And at this point, it's easy again to look down on Jonah, to be a bit self-righteous. But let's remind ourselves of the context. The Assyrians were the equivalent of the Nazis of the ancient world. They were the most militarized, violent, and conquest empire the world had seen up to that point. They constructed towers out of the severed heads of their enemies. They skinned people alive and impaled people on stakes. Nineveh is located in the modern-day Iraqi city of Mosul. Actually, if you Google this phrase, Lachish Reliefs, that's spelled L-A-C-H-I-S-H, you'll find these set of wood carvings. They've actually made their way to the British Museum now, and they've been excavated in Mosul, and they depict the Assyrian conquest of the Israelite city of Lachish. And the carvings graphically illustrate what the Assyrians did to the Israelite people. But actually, let's stay in the city of Mosul and fast forward to 2014, 6 years ago, when it had been captured by ISIS, who were terrorizing the region and beheading those they deemed as infidels. And on the 24th of July 2014, ISIS destroyed Jonah's tomb, which is believed to be Jonah's final resting place and is a sacred site for Muslims, Christians and Jews. Actually, there's an irony in the story, because by blowing up Jonah's tomb, they actually led archaeologists to subsequently discover a 2,600-year-old Assyrian palace beneath, which had never been excavated before. But imagine this. Imagine back in 2014, God had called you to go and preach to ISIS in Mosul. And you know that God will forgive them and extend his grace and mercy to them. When you read this book, you have to pretend that Jonah's being called to that person or people group that you hate the most. No wonder Jonah reacted like he did. This is the scandal of God's grace. I've been reading a great little book called Sympathy for Jonah. And the writer says this: the grace of God is awful to us because the proper response to evil is to fear it and desire its destruction, not to love it and desire its redemption. You know, grace is okay when it's to people like us. Grace is easy when we're in control. But God is not on anyone's side. He's on everyone's side. He's extending grace and compassion to everyone. And if you're listening today, God is extending grace to you. He's reaching out to you. What's our heart posture to the grace that has saved us? In Genesis 12, God called Abram and blessed him and his family to be a blessing to the whole world. And that's still our family business. Can we forgive our worst enemy and be a channel through which God's redeeming love can flow to them? Now, you know, as a lawyer, there's nothing more enjoyable in court than taking somebody's words and turning them against them to establish your case. I'm sorry, but that's just the truth. And this is exactly what Jonah tries to do against God in verse 2. He quotes Exodus 34, verse 6, which is one of the most famous verses in the Old Testament. And it's God's description of himself. And it was part of God's covenant renewal with Israel on Mount Sinai when they'd been unfaithful to him and made the golden calf. And God renews the covenant. God is gracious, compassionate, slow to anger, abounding in love, and relents from destroying people. You know, it reminds me of that phrase in the Jesus Storybook Bible. God loves us with a never stopping, never giving up, unbreaking, always and forever love. And God created us like angled mirrors to reflect him to those around us. And today we may need to respond to him by inviting the Holy Spirit to transform us and to help us reflect his scandalous grace, love, and compassion to those around us. And finally, radical enemy love. As I said earlier, Jonah ends with a question, and it's a bit like we've got a missing chapter at the end of the book. Well, Jesus is the fifth chapter of Jonah. Jesus follows on from Jonah. He rolled up his sleeves and he entered into enemy territory. He entered into our world and our story. And Jesus calls us to radical enemy love. In Matthew chapter 5, verses 43 to 44, Jesus calls us to turn enemies into neighbors by loving them and praying for them. And you know, if we love our enemies, we end up with no enemies and only neighbors. That's what the parable of the Good Samaritan is all about. Again, in that book, Sympathy for Jonah, it says this: it is to the continuing works of interruption that Jesus calls his disciples, to radical acts of enemy love, to radical declarations of grace and forgiveness, to radical transgressions of social boundaries, and radical compassion for total monsters. Enemy love was the hallmark of the early church. Now, to some of us, enemies may be not obvious, but a good question to ask yourself is, who do I vent and complain about to my friends and my colleagues? That's the person that God is calling you to love today. And ultimately, Jesus' radical enemy love led him to the cross. Jesus died for his enemies. He died for us, demonstrating the realities of God's never stopping, never giving up, unbreaking, always and forever love. So just as we finish, I wanted to just tell you something I'd seen in a book called The Powers That Be by a guy called Walter Wink. And he talks in this about how our enemy can be a gift to us. They enable us to see aspects of ourselves that we cannot discover in any other way. The enemy can be the way to God as they hold a mirror up to us. Jonah's attitude to the Ninevites revealed the state of his heart. And Walter Wink, in his book, gives people a practical challenge. He says this: in workshops on this theme, I invite people to name an enemy and list all the things they dislike about that person or group or movement or nation. Then we ask them to go through that list and ask how many of those characteristics are also true of themselves or group or movement or nation. These can be taken into our meditation, prayer, and spiritual guidance to see what they teach us about ourselves. Now, there's a challenge. Today, let God, through these verses from Jonah, hold a mirror up to us and transform us by his radical grace and love. You know, in a minute, we're going to respond in some sung worship. But before we do that, we're going to take a moment to reflect, because God is speaking to all of us and he wants us all to respond to him. And it's a chance to ask God, what are you saying to me? For some of us, our response might be to request prayer from one of the team. For others, you may never have become a follower of Jesus, and you might want to say, today, I want to build my life on you, Jesus. You died for me, and I want to build my life on you. And you may need to click that raise hand button in the chat and request somebody to pray for you. Let's all take a moment to respond.
Find me in the middle of my fights, my risen Savior, man of grace personified. And in the moments when my thoughts attack my mind, you are the truth I need to find. When everything is poorly, my eyes from you, would you capture my attention? When fear comes knocking, washing over me, would you comfort and assure me you're all I need? My heart. on, lift me over, keep me centered in your love. And the times I failed you, you're the hope that shines through. Take my heart and soul too, I wanna live for only you. When these walls are standing, keeping me from running, come and lift me over, keep me centered in your love. And the times I failed you, you're the hope that shines through. Take my heart and soul too. Oh, when everything is pulling my eyes from you, would you capture my attention? When fear comes knocking, washing over me, would you comfort and assure?
Yes, Lord, we will just continue to praise you throughout all our experiences, whether those are our bad ones or whether those are good ones, because, Lord, you remain the same. You are faithful. You are always a God of love, and you are always a God who listens. You're always a God who comforts. You are always a God who cares for us. And we just really thank you for that, Lord. We thank you for who you are. In Jesus' name, amen. Yeah, so thank you so much, Adam, for that talk. That was wonderful. And if you felt like you connected with anything specific that Adam said, then do feel free now to get some prayer about that. Or indeed, if you felt that you connected with anything that's been said on the public chat, any of the scriptures or the words that have been putting up on there. So here's your opportunity to get some prayer. If you've got your heart fluttering a little bit, you're thinking, oh, I think God might be talking to me, click on the button. That'll take you into a private chat room with one of our prayer team who will be able to pray with you. And we've really been seeing God turning up in those spaces. So feel confident in pressing that. But that's not the only place that you can get prayer, is it, Lorna?
Right. A lot of prayer also happens during the week in small groups. Small groups are a great way to build deeper relationships with people in our church community. So we'd really encourage you to get connected into a small group and experience the support of other people's faith.
Yeah.
Click on the connect button and we'll help you find a group that's right for you.
Yeah, absolutely. And we're just now coming to the end of our service, but it's not the end of church, because what is coming up, Lorna?
Hangout on Zoom.
Absolutely. So Zoom Hangout is really fun. There should be a button coming up in the public chat right now, which will give you the link, Zoom link, so that you come and join us. You need to go and get yourself a cup of coffee, maybe a piece of cake, some crisps, whatever you feel like. And, you know, it's really informal. You can come and go as you want. It's not like you're going to come on and you're like, oh, no, I can't leave. You can leave anytime you want to. It's just like these 10-minute chats with a few people, some people that you may have seen before, some people who are new people. And it's great fun. And we love hanging out there. So I would say I will see you there. But actually, I will let you into a secret. This is pre-recorded. And I'm currently not actually in Birmingham. I'm on a beach in Spain, sunning myself. So sorry, guys. So I won't. But Lorna, you are going to be there, aren't you?
I'll be there.
Yeah. And I will see you the following week, next week.
Oh. Thanks again for joining us today. Our team will be available on the chat and for prayer for the next few minutes, so do connect with us.
Yeah.
Enjoy the rest of your day and have a blessed week.
Yeah. See you. Bye, guys. Bye.
Bye. Bye.